Well, thanks, Sir Roderick, and thanks to the audience for coming. The title was a little bit dull, Million Women Study, but what I'm really going to talk about, which is important, is one of the reasons the study was set up, was to look at questions, look at behaviours, normal sorts of behaviours, what women do, to ask the question, what can women do to stay healthy? I mean, every day there's not just one article or something in the newspaper or on the internet. It's usually lots and lots saying, if you run, you won't get dementia. If you drink orange juice, you won't get breast cancer, etc., etc. And the interesting thing is that the public have a quite a strong sense. A lot of this stuff probably isn't true because a lot of it. It's interesting how people don't or discard a lot of disregard a lot of things that they read, and rightly so, because often people do quite small studies and look at some little subgroup and find something that they think is very newsworthy and rather push that. And what I think I have tried to do in my life is to try and really be real about things and really to just understand and be really clear when one says, what was said today, and it's right actually, if you lose a little, even if you lose a little bit of weight, it's good for you, and that is true. But so I'm going to talk about things that we really know about, and the reason we know about it is combinations based on large numbers, reliable data, not nitpicking through things to see if we can find something that might be of sound very interesting in the short term. And so that's really what I'm going to emphasise, and that's really why I started the Million Women Study, and I will talk about that, I'll get there. But what I'm going to... So the sorts of questions, I'm going to really be looking at the question at these sorts of questions, like what are the effects on health of major lifestyles? And I'm going to talk about lifestyle factors that you can potentially modify, although it's not a lifestyle factor. One of the things we found is that the taller you are, the more likely you are to get cancer. Now, that's interesting in a sort of biological way, but you can't do anything about your height. So it's not in the same, and I'm not going to talk about things that are not modifiable or potentially modifiable here. Now, you'll see that it's very important to know whether effects of some lifestyle factor, I'll say smoking, well, I've got the list down there. I'm going to talk about the pill, hormone replacement therapy, obesity, adiposity, physical activity, alcohol, diet, smoking. These are things you hear about all the time. And it's really important to know whether effects are persistent or not, because you only, for example, take the pill, women only take the pill for a short part of their life, when they're in their 20s, 30s usually. HRT women take at a different age. So you have to ask, does it matter if these drugs, as they are, have an effect? Does it persist or not? So I'm going to talk about that a bit. And I'm also going to just talk about the magnitude of effects. What are the big things? What are the little things? So, and I am going to talk about mostly about things that you hear about on the news, etc. And I'm going to start with, no, before I start with the pill, I'm going to talk about conditions that are important, that people know about, that everyone in the audience here will know about, things that you read about. Heart disease, hip fracture, which is a manifestation of osteoporosis, breast cancer and venous thrombosis. And what I want, the first thing that is really important to understand about all these conditions is that they each have a very characteristic age pattern. Some things, like, and I'll start with venous thrombosis, or thrombosis often people call it, which you all know is associated with the pill, and I'll talk about it in a minute. But you see, for women in their 20s and 30s, thrombosis in the legs that can cause a pulmonary embolus and clot, it's a clot that can occur in the legs and actually go into the lungs, and people can die from it. You see, for women in their 20s and 30s, it's more common than breast cancer, heart disease, and all sorts of other things, which is why, in a way, there's been so much emphasis on thrombosis and clots in women on the pill. It's because in young women, it does occur, whereas heart disease hardly occurs at all, and breast cancer really doesn't pick up until about the 40s. But breast cancer doesn't increase as you get past the 50s. Breast cancer is the most common. Women in their 40s and 50s, breast cancer is the most common condition. But by the time you get to 60s and 70s, heart disease takes over. So all these things are very important when you think about specific effects of different things and what you should be thinking about in terms of disease and what can happen. And as I said, also what's persistent or not. Now you can see how hip fracture really... Oh, well, I've just done the next slide. Oh, I was going to say that anyway. So, but you can see how hip fracture in yellowish goes up very rapidly with age, much more rapidly than, say, heart disease. So heart disease is going up quite a lot, but then hip fracture osteoporosis goes up much faster and overtakes heart disease. And dementia, which... we're starting to work on, and it's very important. Dementia is pretty well unknown before about age 70. Not entirely, but really, and it just takes off and overtakes everything. But really sort of late 80s, 90s. So that the dementia, issues to do with dementia become important later. But one has to ask, is something, and this is these sorts of questions, is there something you can do in your 50s? That will prevent dementia, or is it something you should be doing in your 70s? Are there persistent effects? And it's those sorts of questions. And so age is really important in understanding or trying to understand the effects of many of these exposures. Now, I've already mentioned the pill and the fact that we all, again, reading the paper, clots, and there's this pill, the one pill's worse than the other pill and so forth. But it is right. The thing that one should be concerned about for the pill is really blood clot, because that's what is more common in younger women, unless there's a persistent effect of something that's adverse. And actually, I'm going to talk, I think, but you see, hormone replacement therapy, as people usually call it, although the word replacement is gone now, because I think it was always a silly word and it doesn't replace anything. Well, it might, but it's sort of an idea that it was pushed, and this idea it was replacing things that went wrong after the menopause, which is not necessarily right. But anyway, I'm using HRT because people know the words. You can see that at the age when women take HRT, which is in their 50s and 60s, it's breast cancer, particularly women in their 50s, and heart disease are the biggest issues. I want you to think about these things. As I've said, diseases vary by rates, vary by age. So do lifestyle factors and behaviours vary by age. And one has to ask what are the effects and whether they persist or not, because that's really important in trying to understand the sort of long-term or the short-term and long-term effects. So I'm going to start with the pill, and I'm going to talk, because actually that's how my career started, and I don't know whether... you and the audience are so interested in the pill. But you know, there was a time, the pill came out in the 60s, and it is, although people forget, it is the most widely used drug, which it is, in the world. And it still is the most widely used drug. 600 million women have used it. And there are 120 million currently using it. And interestingly now, there are far more women in sort of mid and low income countries using the pill than in high income countries. But if we think about high income countries today, don't know whether this surprised you or not, but it sort of surprises me that women, if you look at women in their 60s now in the UK, about 80% have ever used the pill for an average of 7 years. So it's quite a long time. And women who are 90 today, 30% have used the pill for an average of about 5 years. So that there's really been, not only is it so widely used, but now really women of all ages have used it. And so there are questions again, like, and there's been a massive amount of research, more than probably on any other drug, I'll call it for these purposes. And we do really know a lot about it. And now the interesting thing is, if you go back in the 60s and 70s, the first adverse effects that were reported were all vascular, things to do with the circulation. The first, in 1961, a year after the pill came out, there were already reports in medical journals of people, young people on the pill with venous thrombosis or blood clots, which were unexpected. By 1962, there were 26 cases reported to the FDA, is the Food and Drug Administration in the US. And so already within years of the pill being made available, there are already reports of adverse effects. Soon after, in 62, the first report of a stroke. 64, the first of coronary heart disease. Now, what all the studies have shown, and there was a huge amount of work done in the 70s, late 60s and 70s, really, that showed that there is a 2 to 4-fold increase in the risk of blood clots, maybe not so large, but not too different for stroke and heart disease. But the important thing is this line down the bottom. But these effects are reversible when women stop taking the pill. There's no persistent risk. So it goes away. So while there are risks, they're reversible. And so you've already seen, but I'll come back to it, that these venous thrombosis is common-ish, but pretty rare when you compare it with other ages. But the most common condition in women who take the pill as a background rate, and people who are not on the pill, but are the age group, so they take the pill, is venous thrombosis. So that is what should be the main concern, and it still is. But you see, the interesting thing is when the pill was first marketed, and there'd been a couple of studies, there'd been some little, well, I would call them little, but they call them large then, studies in Puerto Rico of women given the pill. There was a bit of a worry that there was there may be cancer risks. And actually cancer, when the pill was first marketed, it was cancer people worried about, not vascular disease. But in the 80s and 90s, the emphasis did turn to cancer. And there was a huge controversy. Again, some of you might remember, it's sort of interesting just looking back in time. Equivalent controversy.
When you turn your head.
Pardon?
When you turn your head, I can't hear you at all.
Oh, okay. Can you hear me now?
That's yes, when you're facing
the screen. Okay, I'll turn my body like that. Is that all right?
That's better, yes.
Okay, I'll turn my whole body. Okay, so there was a huge furore about late 1980s about whether the pill caused breast cancer. And some people said it did, and some people said it didn't, and there were big arguments, big scientific arguments. I'm just trying to think of an equivalent thing today. I can't immediately think of how heated it was. And there was something in the paper all the time, someone claiming one thing and the other thing. And I just went to Oxford. That was when I started, I went to Oxford at the end of the 80s, really, in 1989. And it was really clear that someone had to sort out what was going on by actually bringing all the warring parties, you could call them, together, and just asking everyone to put in their original data and to merge it and to see if there really were differences, see what was going on. And we set up this collaborative group on hormonal factors in breast cancer, and we set up in Oxford, and we have meetings every 5 years, it still continues. And the first results were published in 1996. Now, I'm going to be showing probably more detailed results than you need to see, but just you can listen to me if you don't want to look at the figures. But what we found, which was really very unexpected, was we found that, and this is time is on this axis here, and this is like comparison with never users of oral contraceptives. If there were points down here, it would mean pill users did better than never users. If it's up there, they did worse. And we found that people who were taking the pill had and this is a relative risk of 1.2, which means about a 20% increased risk of breast cancer when they were taking it. And this is years of stopping. And by 10 years after stopping, this risk had gone away. So that the worst, and this was very unexpected, because people generally think of cancer being caused something you do now and it has its effect a long time later. But what we found, but there's actually not as much reason to back this up as back up the idea that cancer is caused by long-term exposures to things. It's a commonly held view, but it's not true, and a lot of the work that we've done has shown it's not true. So very unexpectedly, we found when you put the worldwide evidence together, this is from about 50 studies, about 50,000 women with breast cancer, we found that there was increased risk, 20% increased risk, while people take in the few years after stopping, but had gone after about 10 years. It was very clear, and all the divergent studies all fit in once the basic pattern had been clarified. And so the studies weren't disagreeing. It was just that people who were looking at older women who'd stopped the pill long ago were saying there was an increase, and people who were looking at younger women who were still on the pill were saying there was an increase. But there was no difference across studies. And that was really a terribly important finding, and really clear, and that this excess risk of breast cancer is reversible. And you now never, ever hear in the press, after we published this in 1996, there's no discussion anymore about the pill and breast cancer. It's widely accepted. That's what it is. We've also done the same thing for cancers of the ovary and endometrium. And I think what I said before is if you look down here, if the lines are this is never use of the pill, actually cancer of the ovary is reduced in pill takers, as is cancer of the endometrium, the lining of the uterus. So so that contrary to breast cancer, the other sort of cancers in women that are hormone related to hormones, obviously to reproduction or organs of reproduction, the pill actually protects. And this is the length that the pill's been used. The longer people have taken the pill, the greater the protection. You can't see this, but these are different lines on when people stop taking the pill. And essentially, quite different from breast cancer, the pill protects against ovary cancer and cancer of the endometrium or the lining of the womb. And it's a persistent effect. Now, no one could have guessed this. I mean, these are findings that, and we did the same thing of bringing together the worldwide evidence. And until you have all the data together, and you really, and you make sure, and there wasn't variation between studies, and there wasn't variation between some sort of subgroups. Some publish, and you hear, if you eat cereal and you take the pill, you're more likely to get this or something, but. Once you bring all the data together and you look in subgroups, a lot of these sort of little subgroups effects that seem sensational at the time go away. So this is what we found, and I am leading into the Million Women study now, but you see 50 years of research has taught us about the pill, and really a huge amount of research that, as I've already said, while the pill is being used, there's increased incidence of vascular disease and also breast cancer, but these effects are reversible. There's no persistent effect. And because most of the serious illnesses in women like breast cancer, cancer of the ovary, heart attack and everything are rare in women in their 20s and 30s, except perhaps venous thrombosis that we've talked about, the numbers who have adverse pill-associated illness is very small. I haven't gone through the absolute rates, but these is like 1 in 100,000 per year, or 1 in 10, very, very small risk. So although there is an increase in conditions that we've talked about, the excess risks, it's unusual to suffer from these side effects. And in the long term, what we have is a persistent decrease in cancer of the ovary and the womb. And we end up, where we are now, is that in the long term, women who've taken the pill, they have a net reduction in cancer incidence. So actually, and there's no one pushes this idea very strongly, but really, I mean, women who've taken the pill are at a reduced, in terms of their cumulative risk, at a reduced risk of cancer, and it really is something that one can say quite, I mean, it's true, and you know, there's so much, what can we do for cancer prevention? But it's interesting that people are very nervous of saying take the pill. It's very interesting, isn't it? Anyway, now HRT. Now, when we were doing bringing together all the data I showed you on the pill and breast cancer, it was really clear that HRT, there was quite a hazard of breast cancer in people on HRT. Most of the data, this was, remember, was in the sort of early 90s. Most of the data at that time came from the US. There wasn't so much use of HRT in the UK at the time. And the sort of, I'll probably easier to explain it when I come to some results, the sort of HRT being used in the UK was not the same as in the US. And also it was clear just from what was going on that HRT use was rocketing in women in the UK. So we decided that we really needed to do a study looking at the association between HRT and breast cancer because, as you can see, most of the users of HRT were women after the menopause in their 50s, and it really was breast cancer that was looking quite worrisome. There had been a trial looking at heart disease as well, women's in the US, and I will talk about that. But they're the two conditions I'm going to talk about as far as HRT is concerned. Now, so we, in a long way, which I won't go through the details, but through the women who were screened for breast cancer at that time were women in their 50s and 60s. And we asked the screening centres, and I'm going to say a bit about screening in a minute, but there's about 100 divisions of, this is England, Scotland, Wales there, which 100, they used to be, I think, not regional health, some health authorities. And in every one of those regions, there was a centre where the spots are, but not all of them got spots. There was the breast screening, there were about 100 centres that ran breast screening through the country responsible for each of those areas. And we, 66 of the breast screening units in the country, and you can see there's some that don't, the ones with the dots in them, the ones that took part, the ones without a dot, oh no, that's got a dot, these ones didn't. Some errors. So the screening, we asked each of the centres separately, and if they agreed, they put a study questionnaire in the envelope when women were invited for screening, and women were asked to fill out questionnaire if they wanted to. They could. We were interested then in HRT and breast cancer, but general women's health in general, and they could fill out a questionnaire. And it was handed in separately from the screening program because we had to show that we weren't in any way changing the way the screening program ran because it was a very efficient organization. We didn't have to change that. So over about a 5-year period, 96 to 2001, we managed to recruit 1.3 million women who were 50 to 6 to 64. That was the age of screen then, which was about 1 in 4 of all the women in the UK, actually, who were aged 50 to 60 at the time. And it was about 70% of the in the areas that... about 1 in 2 in the areas that we covered. And I'm quite sure that some of you... If it's 1 in 4 women who are aged 50 to 64 at the time, I'm quite sure some of you in the audience are part of that. And... we send you questionnaires from time to time, and it's very hard to say thank you in person to so many people. So I will say in person to you, and if this is recorded, I'll say to people who look at this over the internet as well. This study obviously wouldn't exist, and it didn't, and without you, and with the questions, I think people often think, how can these rather simple questions really help? But we do a lot of repeat, we sometimes send you might have got the same questionnaire again where we ask the same question later and look at the how well things agree. And actually, you'd be surprised because I think when you fill these questions in, you think, oh, I'm just saying something off the top of my head, but people tend to say the same thing over and over again. And we've got blood and we do all sorts of tests, and basically the answers are much more reliable. It's more important to give a rough answer than to leave things blank if you're not sure, and we always say that. Anyway, if you did fill one in, and anyway, when women were recruited in the study, they were 56 on average. Now, 40 years later, they're 70. And that's why I think I said that we're starting to get interested in, and I really want to do work. I started with the pill and HRT. We're going to start doing serious work on dementia next, but I'm not talking about dementia now because women are just starting to develop dementia. Now, so that's the Million Women Study, and we set up to look at, it was really breast cancer and hormone replacement therapy. Now, this hasn't come out, it's probably good enough. Now, these are actually real rates. This is in 1,000 women over a five-year period. If they're never, and we've put together, and it shows you how common breast cancer is, so much more common than cancer of the ovary. It still does occur, and cancer of the endometrium. No, ovary's on the top, sorry. This is endometrium, the worm, and this is ovary. Breast cancer is, and never uses, is so much more common than the other two cancers. So if you have even a small effect on breast cancer in terms of how common it is, it affects large numbers of people. And I'd said before that the type of HRT used by women in the UK was not the same as in the US. I'll turn that way. In the US, most of the HRT users used just preparations, just had estrogens in them. And so that's, but in the UK, but what had been shown before was that HRT containing estrogens only increased the risk of cancer of the womb, cancer of the endometrium, which was known about. So in the UK, much more in the States, they said anyone who has got a womb should be given, instead of saying something else, but they added something else. Sort of just saying, well, maybe you shouldn't take it or something. I said, well, let's put in another hormone. So you've got estrogen plus progesterone, which, as you can see, women who are taking estrogen plus progesterone, and this is much more used in Europe and the UK than in the US. So women, it is true that women who took estrogen plus progesterone didn't have an increase in cancer of the endometrium, whereas they did if they had estrogen only. But little did people know, the gynecologists know, that what they were doing by adding progesterone is increasing the risks of breast cancer really quite substantially. Ovary cancer, although the numbers look very small, is slightly increased in pill users, but it's small. And you can really see how the when you put all the cancer, hormone-related cancers together, it's breast cancer that predominates. And as I was saying, if you put them all together, in 5 years, about 20 women in 1,000, so 2 in 1,000, will get one of these cancers over a five-year period. This is women in their 50s and early 60s. So it's not a small number, 2 in 2%, 2 in 100. If you take estrogen plus progesterone, it goes up to over 3. So it sort of becomes 3% instead of 2%. Now, that means that one woman in 100 over a five-year period, there's for every 100 taking HRT, one more is getting breast cancer. It's quite a big number. It's not a small number. As I said, the pill-related things are in the 1 in 10,000, 1 in 100,000. This is 1 in 100. Much bigger effects. And studies in Europe have generally found exactly the same. As I said, in the States, this estrogen only tends to be used, and it's not half as bad as adding the progesterone. The other thing, though, that we found, just as with the pill, that the excess risk, and this is like in the same format as I showed for the pill, that although there's an increase, much bigger, it was about 20% increase for the pill, current use of the pill, it's about a 70% increase. But again, after stopping, and here it seemed like sort of 4 or 5 years after stopping, the risks were the same as never users. So the good news and the important news is that it's reversible. The effects of HRT on breast cancer are reversible. So although there is an increased risk, as with the pill, it seems to be a short-term effect. Now, I'm not going to talk about coronary. We're just analysing that now, and these are results from the randomised trial. Randomised trials that were done in America, as I said, at the same time about as we started the Million Women Study. Basically, the HRT use was increasing very rapidly during the 90s because it was widely said that if women who took HRT, their risk of heart disease was reduced and that they would live longer and so forth, and all sorts of claims. But the randomised trials, I won't go through and explain this, but basically it didn't matter whether taking oestrogen only or oestrogen plus progesterone. There was really little evidence. There was certainly no decrease in risk, and not much to say there was an increase. And the MHRA, which is like our FDA equivalent here, they said, yes, they said there's little, I won't go through, they said there's no, because some people argue if you start when you're very young, it's beneficial, but there's really not much evidence to say it's beneficial. And so that the result, anyway, so that so we published on breast cancer, and the trials in the US published about the same time the trials in the US published 2002, and we published our results on breast cancer 2003. And you can see this extraordinary thing that happened in the UK. In a very short, since about the mid-80s, use of HRT went from almost no one to 2.5 million users in the UK. But with the results, particularly of the trial showing there wasn't a benefit of cardiovascular disease, and possibly, they said, possible decrease, and us showing, and others showing the increase in breast cancer, there's been this rapid decline. Hasn't gone away completely, and actually we've got some even more recent figures. It looks as if it's levelling off, so it's not gone down at all. So there's still about 1 million users of HRT in the country, and that's where we live. But it is interesting to see how rapidly and how the public actually realised this was real. And, you know, I said before that a lot of the findings that you hear about when in the media and so forth, people don't react to, but they reacted to this very well. And I think I think that people who read the papers, listen to things, seem to know the difference between reality and what's real and what's hype. And this was real. But it's particularly breast cancer that is the problem. And it's just interesting to see how rapidly use fell. And also showing that it wasn't the elixir of youth or whatever it was sold as. And what has been published since then, I said it's reversible, the effects. And the drop in HRT use, this is a bit complicated to see. You don't have to see this. So this is data from the States where use of HRT fell very quickly and breast cancer incidence fell. And it was particularly breast cancers that are responsive, that are called the estrogen with estrogen receptors. So, and that's been in a dozen countries now. So that following this drop in use of HRT, breast cancer rates have dropped slightly in women in their 50s and 60s. Interestingly enough, I'll just show this, I'm not saying anything about it, but coincident with the drop in HRT use in the UK, and I presume, or this is English data for England, but I presume it's true everywhere, many other places, there's been an increase in the prescription of drugs called bisphosphonates. I should have said, actually, I should have said that HRT is very good for the bones and that there is a reduction in fractures and osteoporosis, but it's while women are taking HRT. But if you remember, it was women in their 80s who get osteoporosis, late 70s and 80s osteoporosis and fractures and problems with osteoporosis. And taking HRT when you're 50 isn't going to help osteoporosis when you're in your 70s and 80s. And so what's happened is these drugs called bisphosphonates have been just taken over. I mean, it's very interesting how doctors can't quite they don't want to prescribe something else. If we can't, if you're not prescribing HRT, we'll try something else. And I'll tell you, we know almost nothing about what bisphosphonates do, and that's another thing that we're planning to do in the future. But they've taken over from HRT. Some of you are probably on it. Now, I just want to say, and I put this in, and don't worry about the graphs, but I just want to say, although I've not done work on this, but we did recruit through the screening centres, and that's what there's been a lot of fuss about in the media lately. You've probably read that, and probably, and actually, I know from attendance figures that people have pretty well ignored all the fuss, because there's been a lobby saying that breast screening doesn't work and you shouldn't go and does more harm than good. Well, it's just not true. And there was a big review, and there have been a dozen trials. This is just to show you that there have been, these are different trials in the USA, Sweden, another Sweden, UK, Canadian, Sweden, Finland, UK. All these trials, randomising people who screen or not, have shown benefits. And there's been a lot in the media about that. And finally, the government set up an independent review, and they said, yes, it does save lives, saves about 1,400 fewer deaths from breast cancer in England every year because of screening. I just want to say, it's not my research, but it's not a behaviour either, but screening does work and does reduce deaths from breast cancer, and there's not much we can do otherwise about breast cancer, so it's important. But I'm going to go on to, and I'm going to just look at the time. I'm just going to talk, as I said, about, so that's the pill and HRT. HRT, not great. If people have very bad menopausal symptoms, and that's what the MHRA, I was going to say that, the FDA equivalent says, if you want to, women should take HRT for as short a time as possible for real symptoms. But there's a bit of a movement now, the drug company and people who made a nice living out of HRT beginning to try and say, all the evidence was wrong and it was 10 years ago, ignore everything that's happened and go back to HRT. There's quite a push. This is it's interesting, all these lobbies. As I said, there's been an anti-screening lobby. There's a growing pro-HRT lobby. One has to. But as I say, I think people are fairly sensitive to all these things. Obesity. As I said, we heard today's news event is if you lose a little bit of weight, it's good. And the answer is that's right. Now, all of this is a bit too much. I'm not going to go through this in detail. To just say, we've looked, because the study is so big, they're about, out of the 1.3 million, there are about 100,000 women who have developed cancer of some sort. And so we have a lot of statistical power where we can just see exactly what does. And this is a 10-unit increase in BMI. It's like being from normal weight to obese. It's that sort of. So if you go from normalish weight to obese, what happens to cancer risks? And there are 18. We've taken the 18 most common cancers here. I'm not going to go through them all, but if there's a square on this side, it means obesity is bad for you. If there's a square on this side, it means it's good for you. Now, for most of the cancers, and particularly the endometrium, which I've talked about a lot, the cancer of the womb, the difference between a normal weight woman and someone who's obese, the obese woman is 2.8, almost three times as likely to get endometrial cancer, and so forth and so forth. I'm not going to go through them all. Smaller effects for some things, but 9 out of the 18, down to here, there's all significant increases with obesity. Some of the ones, there's no effect with obesity, and funnily enough, and two, really, cancer of the lung and squamous cell, one of the cancers of the throat, there's a decreased risk. But mostly, being obese is not good for cancer. It's much worse for other things, though. And this is for cancer risks. And here, for conditions for the, if we take the 20, we took the 25 most common conditions women admitted to hospital for, and for 21 out of the 25, being obese was a bad thing. topped by, as you all know, diabetes. But the second, again, which people don't know so well, is knee replacements. It's almost the effect of obesity, the magnitude of the effect of obesity is almost as bad as for diabetes. Women who are obese are much more likely to have knee replacement, have knee problems. Venous thrombosis is quite high, and gallbladder disease, carpal tunnel syndrome, atrial fibrillation, hip replacements. These things are all more common. Ischemic heart disease down here, which you hear about. So I haven't shown all the list, but again, obesity is bad for most things. It's good for just a few things, very small number of things. And it is true. Now, I'm going to show, I think this is the most difficult, hang on. I'm just going to show you endometrial cancer. I'm showing you risks by, these are body mass index. Now, this is normal weight, 30 is obese, and 40 is what is called morbidly obese, like really hugely obese. People who are morbidly obese have eight times more likely to get endometrial cancer of the womb than normal weight women. But the next slide, so this just shows you, and there's a linear relationship, the more obese you are, the greater the risk. Next slide is a bit complicated, and I'm just going to tell you what it shows because it's a little bit hard, and I'm sorry about this. But this shows what your body size was. We asked people, and we've been able to validate and show that this was true when we've got actual measurements. People who were thin and average or plump when they were 10, and this is what they were when they were 10, and these things are what their BMI is now, what they are now. And this is saying women who were not overweight, who are normal weight now in their 50s and 60s, it didn't really matter, their endometrial cancer risk didn't really matter whether they were thin, average or plump when they were 10. Likewise, if women were obese now, it didn't really, that's just a sort of a bit of a, that's a, no, random error, that's not really, and these numbers aren't significantly different. So people who were obese now, didn't matter if they were thin, average, or plump when they were 10. And similarly, people who were, this is called overweight group, didn't matter if they're thin, average, or plump. So what this is saying, and really important, is that it's what you weigh now that's important. It doesn't seem to be a persistent effect from the past. There is a persistent effect, you can say, that most people who were thin when they were, who were obese, who were plump when they were young, end up plump when they're older. But if you look in within strata and hold these things constant, it looks as if there's not much effect on endometrial cancer and on the other cancers we've looked at, what you were when you were younger. And this is, you know, the extremes are here. Like if you're lean at 10 and obese at 60, you're the same as if you were plump at 10 and obese at 60. And these people who are plump at 10 but lean at 60, and they're the same. So the extension of this is, it's what you are now that matters. It's what you are now that matters. And in a way, it also is sort of implying these things are reversible. You don't have, what happens to you at a certain age, if you get to 60, it's what you are at 60 that matters, not what you were when you were 10. So it's a bit of a similar sort of message to the pill or HRT, that it really is what you do now that matters. And so that's why what I said was right, what was in the news today, losing some weight now can help you, because it's what you are now and that is important. And that's, I think, should be seen as quite a relief to people, that you can still change. If you change your behaviour now, if you change your weight now, it will have, it's worthwhile. Oh, I'm not going to show that. Physical activity. Just to say, yes, physical activity matters, but it matters in different ways for different conditions. And we've just looked at fractures, for example. These are people who were active, this is rarely, never, once or more than once. For hip fracture, the more active you were when you filled out the questionnaire, the more active you were. We then followed people for hip, see if they had hip fractures being active was very good for hip fractures. But interestingly enough, for ankle fractures and for wrist fractures too, more, if anything, there was no effect or even a slight increase. And I think that, again, if you're more active, you can sort of fall over more. But the very serious, but the very serious hip fractures, you're protected against, presumably because, well, for all sorts of reasons, I won't say. But it's just to say that it's not always the same for every condition, and not all fractures are the same. Now, we've just got this result, which we haven't published yet, and it's a bit curious, but we've also looked at physical activity and vascular disease, and this is heart disease, this is stroke, and this is blood clots, venous thromboembolism. And this is quite curious in that people who are in it pretty well inactive, say, and this is strenuous activity, say they rarely or never do anything. Compared with them, if some sort of activity once up to once a week, 2 to 3 times a week, it's a very good thing, as one has heard, and that's true. But we do find this odd thing here that the very active, more than being active more than 3 times a week doing activities, there seems to be an increase in risk. As I say, that's not published yet. Curious, and it may fit with, you know, you often hear about people being very, very active and then having some catastrophic vascular event, and maybe, and that might be, I don't know what our data is showing too. But generally, for most people, physical activity is a good thing for heart disease and stroke. But maybe one shouldn't overdo it. I don't know. Alcohol. Alcohol and diet. Now, I'm just going to show you this. It's very important because there's a lot of talk about alcohol and cirrhosis. And I think mortality from most conditions in the UK is falling, particularly from vascular, is falling very rapidly. People are getting, you know, the expectation of life's increasing very fast. But one of the few conditions where the incidence rates are really going up quite rapidly is cirrhosis of the liver. And it's not only alcohol. All I was going to say is that it's certainly, and it's even with, this is alcohol units a day. This is people who, this is women. Women don't drink very much. The average is less than, for women in general, is less than one drink a day. But for women who drink about one drink a day, they've got a significantly greater risk of cirrhosis. So one drink a day is enough to do this. Once you get to sort of just almost three, you can see they're very big risks. They go up quite fast. But there's also a difference between non-obese and obese. At every level of alcohol consumption, obese people have higher rates of cirrhosis. And probably the reason cirrhosis is going up is a combination of people drinking more and being more obese, because rates are really going up very fast. And as I say, women don't drink much, but even at the very small levels, one drink a day on average, 2 drinks a day, you can see the effects. I hope that's not my phone. Right. Now I'm going to say the same alcohol. Also, if you do the same, I showed you this long plot with different sorts of cancers for obesity. If you do alcohol, if you look at alcohol, alcohol does affect some cancers. It's not as great an effect as obesity, but the one that's really important, particularly for women, is it does increase breast cancer risk. And so it's 12% for 10 grams. This is grams a day I'm talking about, not obesity. This is for one drink a day on average. So it is about a 12% increase for every drink. So compared with none, women who drink nothing, women who drink one drink a day on average have about a 12% higher risk of breast cancer. If they drink 2 days, it's two drinks a day, it's 24, and so forth. And again, it's because breast cancer is really common in women, this is quite an important result. But you will see, which others have reported too, that some cancers are reduced with alcohol. So it's not a totally simple picture, but because the size of these squares tells you something about how common diseases are, and breast cancer really dominates the picture. We also find, I mean, as others have found, but basically the only the cancers that are affected by alcohol are, not surprisingly, the ones of the mouth, the larynx, the pharynx, it's sort of the esophagus, the gullet, and the liver. It's not surprising the ones are increased, and most of the other cancers are not increased. So that's alcohol. Just to say, that it doesn't matter. This just shows people who just drink only wine or other mixtures. It doesn't matter. It's the same. It doesn't matter whether it's where the alcohol comes from. The effects look the same. Fibre. Now, fibre is very. Now, fruit, diet and fibre. I'm just going to show you one slide that we've got. Diverticular disease of the bowel is a condition where in the colon you get little pockets that can get infected. It's and cause all sorts of abdominal problems. We really found a strong association. The more fibre you ate, the less likely that was to be. But we're actually having trouble finding or reproducing what other people have found about diet. So that if I just say for the moment that much of what you read about diet and anything, we don't exactly reproduce. And lastly, smoking. And I just want... You hear about smoking and people are sick and tired of hearing about smoking because everyone knows that smoking is bad for you. But it's really bad for you, really bad for you. And the more often it's said, it doesn't matter because it just is the big killer. Only 20% of people smoke now. In the old days it was 60-70%. Well, women never, but women got up to 50%. Smoking rates are going down, and that's really good. But still, overall, about 20% of cancers, or 20% of excess mortality in the UK is in smokers. And what you can see now, just this is something that... This is numbers of cigarettes per day. This is never smokers. It's the same sort of idea. This is people who smoke... women who smoke 10 cigarettes a day... seems like not much, have double the risk of dying than people who don't smoke. Double, just with 10 cigarettes a day. I've talked about the pill and things like it might be a 20% increase. This is a 100% increase, double. If women smoked 20 cigarettes a day, it's almost a fourfold increase. These are very large, very large effects. There was an idea that maybe women smokers, it wasn't so bad in women or something, but... For women, because in our cohort, remember, women were sort of 56 when they started. The ones who were current smokers have been smoking. They started smoking on average sort of about age 18. These are people who'd smoked for like 40 years. 40 years of smoking is really not good. I'm not going to show that. But the important thing, again, and it's a bit complicated to explain, but I'm going to say that, remember I said it was about double, the relative risk was about 2 if you smoked 10 cigarettes a day and 4 if you smoked 20. But the average consumption is about 15 a day with an increase of 3. So that there was, in all current smokers in the study, there was a threefold increase in deaths from all causes. And this is never smokers down here. But if you look at the age when people, in ex-smokers, this is ex-smokers down here, at the age when they stopped. Women who stopped smoking, say had started but stopped smoking just in their sort of early 20s, they really didn't have an increase in mortality. So having started but stopped in their 20s, really there was almost nothing. When we look at lung cancer, there's a small increase. There's still a tiny increase in lung cancer mortality, even if you started at 20. But even if you stopped at 20, but effectively stopping at 20 or in your 20s, takes away any of the excess risk if you continue. Stopping even at 30, which many people do, and it's much people in 30, people's lives are much more sort of settled at 30, and even if they smoke, I mean, it sounds, but even to stop it, but to stop at 30, instead of a 200% increase, is a 5% increase. It's actually significant. The numbers are big enough to say this increase, even at 30, even stopping at 30, you've got a higher death rate in your 50s and 60s than people who never smoked. But you've lost some sort of 97% of the excess risk if you continue. And even stopping at 40, instead of being 200-fold, there's a 20% increased risk. So that's you've lost 90% of the effect of continuing. So the important, because again, and it really, you can hear the message through everything I'm saying. What you do now does, or what you do does have an effect. If you stop smoking, even if you stop at 50, you still do quite well. So stopping smoking now, if you're a smoker, will benefit you and benefit you quite quickly. Losing some weight now will benefit you. Not, you know, if you did take HRT, stopping it, you go back to the same risk as if you'd never taken it after a couple of years. So that is really the main message that I want to leave you with, is that the risks for behaviour doesn't have as long-term effects and as persistent effects, I think, as many people believe. And so it's sort of good news that most of the things that we know about that are harmful, if you change what you do, it will affect your disease. Thanks very much. I think that's... Oh, no, I've got one more. But definitely...